Davante Adams legitimately has one of the greatest turnaround stories in NFL history. Over the past 4 years, the Packers receiver has consistently been one of the top receivers in the league, even while playing with a slightly lesser version of Aaron Rodgers, so it's easy to forget just how rocky his start was. Many players improve over the course of their careers to go from below average to good. However, Adams might be the only player ever to go from potentially the worst player in the league at his position to the best player in the league at his position. Yes, that's right, Davante Adams is currently the best wide receiver in the NFL, and I don't think it's much of a debate. He has completely transformed from a player who couldn't produce with an injury-ravaged receiver room and an elite quarterback into the most complete all-around player at the position. Adams has completely dominated this season in all statistical categories, ranking in the top 10 of receptions, yards, and touchdowns, despite missing two games and part of another. It's Adams' fourth straight Pro Bowl season, so it's understandable why people often forget how his career began in Green Bay, but it is in fact very crucial to his success story. Adams wouldn't be the receiver he is today without those tough times. How bad was he in those first 2 years, though? Am I exaggerating by saying that he was the worst receiver in the NFL? Maybe, but if you look at the numbers, it wouldn't be by much. As a second-round rookie in 2014, Adams was far behind Jordy Nelson and Randall Cobb as the Packers' default third receiver, putting up a nondescript line of 38 catches, 446 yards, and 3 scores. Those numbers may not look too bad, but the advanced analytics tell the whole story. He was PFF's 92nd ranked receiver among 101 eligible players as a rookie. Among 84 receivers with at least 50 targets, Adams ranked 82nd in yards per route run, the more indicative statistic of receiver play than yards per catch or yards per target. He was ahead of just Hakeem Nicks and Jason Avant, who were each out of the league a year later. In number fires efficiency metric reception net expected points per target, Adams ranked 62nd out of 90 receivers. Adams really stood out, if you want to call it that, in Matt Harmon's Reception Perception Project. He had a 51% success rate against press coverage, which ranked in the 11th percentile of all receivers. His 47% success rate against man coverage put him in the 2nd percentile, and his 55.2% success rate against zone coverage put him in the 1st percentile. A reminder for those not used to working with percentiles, low numbers are bad. Being in the first percentile means that 99% of receivers perform better than him. Adams had a chance to improve his stock in 2015 when Jordy Nelson went down with a torn ACL in the preseason, but he wound up somehow having an even worse sophomore season. His PFF grade dropped to 101st out of 121 eligible receivers. He had the 5th lowest yards per route run of 81 eligible receivers. Of 86 receivers with at least 50 catches, Adams ranked 85th in DYAR and 83rd in DVOA in 2015. At the time, his reception NEP per target average that season ranked 1,186th out of 1,198 receivers since 2000. The only guys worse than that played with quarterbacks such as Dan Orlovsky, Blaine Gabbert, Chad Henne, and Brandon Whedon. Adams' 53.2% catch rate was the 7th lowest among receivers with 90-plus targets. The only guys who ranked worse than him were all deep threats, all but one of them averaging over 16 yards per catch. Adams, meanwhile, averaged a staggeringly low 9.7 yards per catch. Out of 154 eligible receivers, Adams was just 148th in yards per target at a measly 5.1 average. He was ahead of only 5 running backs in Eddie Royal. On top of all of that, Adams was also 6th in the league with 10 drops in 2015. But enough of the negativity. I'm harping on how bad Adams was to start his career not as a knock on him, but because, as I said before, it makes his phenomenal play now even more impressive. Adams, quite frankly, could not do either of the two main jobs of a receiver in his first 2 years, getting open or catching the ball. Cut to today, and he is lauded for his route running excellence and his sure hands. Packers fans were calling for him to be cut just a couple of years ago, and now they think it's blasphemous to rank anybody above him. Davante Adams is the perfect case of why you shouldn't give up on clearly talented receivers who oftentimes struggle early in their careers. What I'm saying is, ease up just a bit on Diontae Johnson, will ya, Steelers fans? Excluding chronic offenders, for most receivers, drops are a random statistic that you should not center your analysis around. After Adams' 10 drops in 2015, he has steadily decreased that number in the following years, to the point where through 16 weeks this season, he is one of just 5 receivers with at least 50 targets and a drop ball percentage below 1.0. His immediate improvement in 2016, however, wasn't due to eliminating drops, as he still dropped 9 passes. Where he really shined was improving his hand strength in contested situations. Adams led all receivers with a nice 69.6% catch rate on targets where he had less than a yard of separation. This helped Adams come in second in the league in touchdown catches behind only his teammate Jordy Nelson. Now, prior to this year, Adams had the poor luck of having his best years and Aaron Rodgers' worst years, so his stats never really leapt off the page too well. 2020 is actually just the second 1,000-yard season of Adams' career, though he came up literally 3 yards short of the mark 2 different times. Where Adams' true improvement can be seen is in his ever-important route running. Whereas Adams used to be among the worst-ranked receivers in terms of getting open, he has completely flipped that script in an unprecedented way. He was in the second percentile of success rate against man coverage in 2014, but a mere 4 years later, he was in the 99th percentile in that category. His 79.5 success rate in 2018 was the 5th highest mark since 2014, which is when those numbers began being tracked. He also went from 1st to 94th percentiles in zone coverage, and 11th to 92nd against press. And even though Adams' box score stats suffered a bit the following year in 2019 thanks to a more run-heavy approach, his reception perception did not, as he ranked in the 96th percentile against man, and he actually improved his success rate against press. Adams' route running isn't as flashy as that of, say, Stephon Diggs, who many see as the best route runner in the sport, but it's arguably as efficient. In fact, what makes Adams stand out as a route runner is something that would be a death sentence for most receivers. Adams starts nearly every single pass play the same exact way with a little hop step, which most coaches preach against because it leaves receivers open to being jammed. However, because Adams is so quick, he's able to use it to his advantage to read the DB and react to their first step so that he can get to an open area. In that sense, Adams starts every route the same way, but he never actually runs the same route twice because it's all dependent on the corner's actions. It's unnatural, but it works all the same because Adams is one of the few who is talented enough to pull it off. Adams broke down his route running in further detail in a video with Brian Baldinger from this summer, which I urge you to check out. This year, Adams saved his best for the end of the season as he put on a wide receiver performance for the ages in a Sunday night win against Tennessee. He caught 11 of 12 targets thrown his way for 142 yards and 3 touchdowns, upping his total for the season to 17. With those 17 scores this year, Adams now is tied for the 5th most TD catches in a single season in NFL history, and he still has one game to go, not to mention the fact that he already missed 2.5 games earlier this year. It was his second 3 TD game this season and his 5th multi-score performance in total. He's also now gone over 100 yards in 7 of his 13 games played this year. Even with all the missed time, Adams has been able to climb near the top of every single volume statistical category because of how dominant he's been. However, even with the great numbers, what made this game so great was how Adams didn't miss a beat even with the snowy field, which would theoretically hinder a player who succeeds in the ways he does. Instead, Adams still made DBs look silly with his elite route running all night. He showed off his fancy footwork in the end zone with this toe-dragging score, and his strong hands with this spectacular falling sideline catch to cap the night. In 2020, Adams is combining his advanced stats with loaded box score stats thanks to a rejuvenated Aaron Rodgers, and people are finally coming around to acknowledging him as one of the top receivers in football. He may not be as fast as Tyreek Hill, or as monstrous as DK Metcalf, or as dominant at the catch point as DeAndre Hopkins, but because he is still great at each of those individual attributes of being a receiver, he has turned into the most complete player at the position, which is why I consider him to be the best in the league. He's one of the top 2 route runners in the NFL, as reception perception has shown. He has some of the best hands in the league, as his drop rates and contested catch rates have shown. He has the 11th lowest deep ball percentage among 54 wide receivers with at least 10 deep targets, yet he has the 6th most yards on those, so he's a great deep threat too. On top of all that, he's also great after the catch, as his yak mark leads the NFL. It's no wonder that Adams leads the league in PFF grading, yards per route run, and yards per game. Devontae Adams could have easily floated out of the league after his first two seasons in the NFL, but instead, he transformed himself into the absolute best at his position in one of the most dramatic turnaround stories in sports history. In the process, he has perhaps offered some hope to future receivers who fail to find success right away.